Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube videos. In the previous video of this playlist, I proved Chebyshev's inequality. And the reason for that is because Chebyshev's inequality is a key ingredient to prove the weak and strong laws of large numbers, which I'm going to do in the next video. But before that, I'm going to give you another fun application of Chebyshev's inequality and show you how we can use Chebyshev's inequality and other tools in probability to prove an important theorem in functional analysis called Weierstrass theorem. So this theorem states that any continuous function defined on a bounded closed interval can be written as the uniform limit of a sequence of polynomials. Now, without a loss of generality, we can just assume that our continuous function f is just defined on the closed unit interval, 0, 1. And so the traditional proof is just to show that this function f is going to be the uniform limit of the sequence of Bernstein polynomials that are defined here on this slide. I call those polynomial Bn, so that indeed defines a sequence of polynomials. Notice that Bn has degree n, and the goal is to prove that Bn is going to converge uniformly to the function f. So first, to do this, I'm going to define a random variable Zn equal to x1 plus x2 plus xn divided by n, where the random variable xi are assumed to be independent Bernoulli random variable with parameter x. So to make things a little bit easier, I broke down the proof into three steps. And the first step is to prove that the expected value of f of zn is equal to bnx. So I rewrote what we need here to prove the result. The goal is to prove this. I remind you the definition of Bernstein polynomial Zn xi is Bernoulli with parameter x. And so to compute this expected value, I'm just going to use the definition of expected value. So we look at expected value of f of Zn. F of Zn is a random variable. We want to look at, to express this expected value as the sum over all the possible values of f of Zn times the probability that Zn is indeed equal to this value. So the first step is to find the range of Zn. But you see that because those random variables xi are Bernoulli random variables, they can only be equal to 0 or 1. So that means that in the numerator here, you have a sum of n terms that are zeros or ones. So the numerator is an integer between 0 and n. Now, Zn is this, but divided by n. So that means that Zn is of the form k over n, for k going from 0 to n. And, well, that's how you can express the expected value here. So I'm going to look at, so we want to prove that this is equal to this sum here, this Bnx. So here you have a sum over, so we said that this sum here can be anything between 0 and n, so I'm going to look at sum for k equals 0 to n. If the sum is equal to k, then zn is equal to k over n, and f of zn is equal to f of k over n. So we need a f of k over n here. And then times the probability that indeed f of zn is equal to f of k over n, if that's the same as saying that zn itself is equal to k. So we need to multiply, is equal to k over n, sorry. So we need to multiply by the probability that zn is equal to k over n. Okay, so now saying that zn is equal to k over n, that means exactly that the sum here in the numerator is equal to k. Okay, but because those random variables are independent and Bernoulli random variable with the same parameter x, that means that at least in distribution, the sum x1 plus x2 up to xn is a binomial random variable with parameter n, number of trials, number of random variables, and second parameter that the success probability x. And so eventually we get that this probability here is exactly the probability that a binomial random variable with parameter nx is equal to k. So I'm going to write this now. So this is equal to the sum for k equals 0 to n of f of k over n times the probability that a binomial random variable with parameter nx is equal to k. But then, well, we know that, again, like binomial random variable nx equals to k, with probability, number of ways you can choose k successes from n twice, it's n choose k, times probability of success x at the power number of successes, that's k, times probability of failure, that's 1 minus x, at the power number of failures, that's n minus k. And so eventually you get that this sum becomes sum for k equals 0 to n of f of k over n times n choose k times x at the power k, 1 minus x at the power n minus k. And now you recognize, well, exactly the same expression as here. You have your n choose k here, f of k over n, and then the product here, x at the power k, 1 minus x at the power n minus k. So indeed, this sum here is equal to bnx. So this is bnx. So conclusion, indeed, expected value of f of zn is equal to bnx, so that shows step one here. Step two, prove that the probability that zn minus x is larger than delta is less or equal than 1 divided by 4n delta squared. That should be true for all delta strictly positive. So I rewrote what we need to prove here, like the second step. We still have the definition of Zn and Xi here. So that's here that we use Chebyshev's inequality. That's here that we need to use Chebyshev's inequality. Remember that Chebyshev's inequality tells you something about the probability that a random variable is going to deviate from its mean by more than delta, let's say. So the first step is to see that indeed X is the expected value of Zn. Now, to have a bond like this one, we also need to know about the variance of Zn. We know that this is going to be less than the variance of Zn divided by delta square, provided x is indeed the expected value of Zn. So let's check all that. Step one, let's compute expected value of Zn and variance of Zn. So you see that, again, we mention just in step one that the sum here is the sum of independent Bernoulli random variables, so that's a binomial random variable. So the expected value of the sum in the numerator is equal to n times x. Expected value of a binomial with parameter nx is just n times x. And so bilinearly, you have the 1 over n getting out of the expected value also. So indeed, expected value of Zn is equal to nx divided by n. That's equal to x. So this one is indeed the expected value of Zn. I'm going to write that first. So we know that expected value of Zn is indeed equal to x. Now let's look at the variance. Variance of Zn is going to be equal to variance of this fraction here. The 1 over n gets out of the variance, but is squared. So this is just the variance of the sum in the numerator divided by n squared. So that's the variance of x1 plus x2 and so on up to xn. This divided by n squared. Now again, let's use the fact that here we have a sum of independent Bernoulli random variable with parameter x, which means that the sum is binomial with parameter nx. And so that implies that like this variance, the variance of a binomial is well known, is going to be nx times 1 minus x. So eventually the variance here is equal to nx, 1 minus x. You still need to divide by n squared. And so you have eventually this simplification, okay? The n disappears here with the n squared. And so variance is equal to x, 1 minus x over n. Now we can go one step further, and you see here we want a bond that is uniform in x, that does not depend on x. Remember that in our problem here, x is in the interval 0, 1, okay? Indeed, here, that's a success probability, so x is like a probability, it's a number between 0 and 1. And then if you look at the graph of this function, between 0 and 1, well, that's equal x times 1 minus x is equal to 0 for x equals 0, x equals 1. The function is symmetric, the maximum is reached for x equals 1 half, and at 1 half you get 1 half times 1 half, that's 1 fourth. And so eventually the variance is exactly equal to this, which is less or equal to, we said, 1 divided by 4n. Okay? So that's the best possible uniform bond that holds for all x between between 0 and 1. So we have this, and we know also that the variance of Zn, we just proved that the variance of Zn is less than 1 divided by 4n. And well, now we are done. We just need to use Chebyshev's inequality to conclude. So what we get now is that the probability of interest here, probability that Zn minus x is larger than delta. I'm going to like inject this expected value of Zn here, replacing x by expected value of Zn to really insist on the fact that we are indeed looking at the difference between a random variable and its mean, like in Chebyshev's inequality. So this is equal to the probability that the absolute value of Zn minus its expected value is larger than delta. Okay? And we know by Chebyshev's inequality that this is less or equal to the variance of Zn divided by delta square. Okay? But we just proved that the variance of Zn itself is less than 1 over 4n. So eventually, this quantity here is less than 1 divided by 4n delta square. And so that shows indeed the inequality we wanted, like this probability is indeed less than 1 divided by 4n divided by delta square. Finally, we want to deduce from 1 and 2 that indeed the sequence of Bernstein polynomials Bn converges uniformly to the continuous function f. I rewrote on the board what we've just proved, 1 and 2. So now the quantity we want to control is exactly f of x minus bn of x. So more precisely, what we want to do is prove that for all epsilon positive, we can find n large enough such that this quantity is going to be less than epsilon, and that should be true for all x in the unit interval 0, 1. So first obvious thing we want to do, because we know that bnx is equal to expected value of f of zn, we want to replace bnx here in this expression by the expected value here. I'm also going to use the fact that because f of x is deterministic, it's not a random variable, f of x is also equal to its expected value, that's the expected value of a constant, expected value of f of x. And I'm also going to use the fact that the expected value is linear to rewrite this as expected value of f of x minus f of zn. So that's the first step. So this absolute value is equal to absolute value of expected value of f of x minus f of zn. And now at this point, you see that this difference here, because f is continuous, f of x minus f of zn should be small when x and zn are close to each other. That's one case. Now, what happens when x and zn are far from each other? In this case, we don't really have control of this term, but we know that the expected value is again, in this case, going to be small. Why? Well, because of two, we prove that it's possible that zn and x are not close to each other, but this only happens with a small probability. So that's kind of the idea. So the idea now is to split this this absolute value using the triangle inequality into a sum of two expected values, one where x minus zn is going to be larger than delta, and another one where it's going to be smaller than delta, and we can control each term for different reasons, one because of continuity, the other one because we have this bound. So that's kind of the idea, but for that we need to express more explicitly this assumption that f is continuous. So I'm going to write, like, let's say little a. So the first thing we know by continuity is that for all epsilon positive, there exists delta positive. This delta is going to be the delta that we used here, such that absolute value of x minus y less than delta implies that absolute value of f of x minus f of y less than epsilon. Okay, that's one thing we need to use. That's a consequence of continuity. Another consequence of continuity we will need when x and zn are far from each other. Even if this happens with small probability, we still kind of need to control this term. We need to prove that this term does not go to infinity. And that's another consequence of continuity, because f is continuous and defined on the closed interval 0, 1, which is a compact set. We know that f on the interval 0, 1 is going to reach its maximum, and the maximum is finite. And so for that, I'm just going to write that m, by definition, that's going to be the supremum over all x in the interval 0, 1 of absolute value of f of x, or maybe I can use y to show that it might not be the same one as here, f of y. So we know that this quantity must be finite. That's another important theorem in functional analysis. So now, what can we do with this? Well, from that, we can say I continue here my calculation. So we know that this is less or equal to, so expected value, I'm going to write again, so expected value of, now we have, or maybe I can even put the absolute value in the expected value, so I still have an inequality. So that's going to be expected value of absolute value of f of x minus f of z, f of zn. Okay, but now I'm going to look at this indicator function x minus zn less than delta. Okay, so that's the first part. And then the same quantity, but where the inequality is reversed. So plus expected value of f of x minus f of zn, but this time times indicator function on the even that x minus zn is larger or equal to delta. Okay, so here again I'm using triangle inequality, and again the fact that absolute value of the expected value is less than the expected value of the absolute value. So we have this. Now what can we do here? Well, this term we said can be controlled using the fact that so x minus zn is less than delta. So we are in this case, in case number A here. We know that on this event, the difference here is going to be less than epsilon, okay? So this term is less than epsilon, and eventually you end up with this first expected value is going to be less than epsilon times the expected value of this quantity that, again, we don't really control, but clearly expected value of this integer function, that's the probability of this event that's less than one. So that means that this first expected value here, I'm going to write this in red, is going to be less than epsilon, okay? So again, the reasoning is to extract this quantity and say that on this event, because of continuity here, this part is less than epsilon, and so this part is less than epsilon times the probability that x minus zn is less than delta, but that's epsilon times a probability that's less than epsilon. So that's the first part. Second part, for this expected value, now this term is not small, but clearly by definition of m here, now I'm going to use little b because the function is bounded in absolute value by m, which is finite. This difference here should be bounded by 2m. So this is less than 2m. And then, from this same reasoning as before, we can extract this part and say that this second expected value here is less than 2m times the expected value of this integer function. That's exactly 2m times the probability of this event. But we saw already that the probability of this event, that's here, it's less than 1 divided by 4n delta square. So this second expected value eventually is less or equal than, so we said 2m divided by 4n delta square. Okay, and then, so conclusion, maybe I don't need this anymore. Let's go back to our original quantity here. So now what we know is that for all epsilon, we can find n large enough. So for all epsilon, so we can find n large enough such that this quantity is less than epsilon, but also this can be made smaller than epsilon also because, well, m is fixed, the delta depends on epsilon, okay? But n does not depend on epsilon, and so if you take n large enough, you can make this quantity less than epsilon, and so that implies that for all epsilon positive, there exists n large such that this quantity f of x minus bn x is less than epsilon plus epsilon to epsilon. Also, you see that this is true for all x, so that's uniform in x. So indeed, from that, we deduce that the supremum over all x in the interval 0, 1 of the absolute value of f of x minus bn x. So this quantity is indeed going to converge to 0 as n goes to infinity. So indeed, this shows that the sequence of Bernstein polynomial converges to the function f uniformly.